Hey, this is David Ellefson, and you're listening to Sonic Perspectives.
This is Michael the Metal Angel, and it's an honor and a privilege to speak and interview the one and only Dave Ellefson, the true bass player of Megadeth. All right, so you got a brand new book out. I express my ignorance. I have not read it yet. I didn't even know you had a new book out. I read the last one and loved it, so I'm going to definitely get it. So this is the continuing story of, like, the second chapter, like, after you left Megadeth and then came back to Megadeth?
No, not really. It's funny. It's not even like, you know, and that story picks up from here, you know.
Oh, okay.
We liken it to, like, a superhero movie where you sort of recap bit of the first one, and then you go on a whole new voyage.
Okay.
And that's really what this one is. And a lot of it started last year when we were doing an Ellefson Coffee, kind of Midwest coffee tour, we called it.
Right,
and
right.
All of a sudden we're thinking, man, there's been a lot of stuff that's happened over the last just 3-4 years since the last book came out, because I think that came out in 2013.
Yeah.
And, you know, between the label, Ellefson Coffee, we did obviously the big four shows. There's just, you know, several Megadeth records. We won a Grammy. Just a lot of stuff. A lot of really.
And they played the Metallica song while Dave walked
up.
Yeah.
Well, you know, that's, you know, that was just the song they had in the queue. You
right.
Know? It was funny with that because, you know, David Bowie won a lot of awards.
Yeah.
Posthumously, is that how you say that?
Yeah,
word?
Posthumously. Yeah, yeah, absolutely. After death.
And, but, you know, the cues they had lined up were The Who, you know, because they just, they can't have every song because they're in every category. There's six
right.
nominees at
right.
least, and you can't have everyone, okay, Megadeth, go, you know,
right, right.
Or Korn, whoever would have won, right?
Right?
So
right.
at some point they just say, hey, we need a metal track for this. We need a rock right. song for that. We need, yeah, I mean, I remember when I went in 2014, the best children's book. They played Sweet Child of Mine by Guns N' Roses.
That's good.
So, so who knows, right?
And it's a Grammy well deserved, because with the yeah. work you guys did in the 90s, you should have got Grammys, especially for albums like Countdown to Extinction and Euthanasia.
Right, right. I'm not going to argue with you. I think we were, you know, clearly the better band in a lot of those categories.
Oh, by far.
And that's not to disrespect some of the contemporaries that were there, because certainly they were worthy of being in the category. But one of the things that I found over the years is that, you know, and I think probably the reason even the Grammys are so thrilled about our win on Dystopia, because I think it shows that, you know, you don't just get nominated once, flash in the pan, and then you go away. You know,
right.
there's a lot of award shows that are for that. They're,
right.
they're clearly the popular.
And there's vote. Awards for award shows.
Yeah, the Grammys are not a popular award show. It's like the Oscars. It's the Academy, and it's the members of the Academy that vote. And the constituents, if you will, are the voters of the record labels. So it's a very industry-centric you know, Academy and award show. As a, you know, Dick Clark, American Music, which is a great show. I love to watch it. And they're
right.
generally the more popular. Whoever's more popular usually wins. Billboard, based on chart sales. But the Grammys is very nebulous, and you really don't know who's going to win.
Right,
and
right.
I think for us that...
Motorhead got nominated for covering a Metallica song. So,
well,
you know.
Yeah, what I started to see is that usually the elder statesman band over the years, because we're in categories with Judas Priest and Iron Maiden and Motorhead and stuff, usually the elder statesman bands generally were winning.
Right.
Which I think, at least in the metal category, they were.
Right.
And, which, you know, there's a couple, I think when we were in there with Maiden and Priest, you're kind of going, you know, they kind of deserve to win.
I mean, absolutely.
They are ahead of us. They haven't won yet.
Right,
and
right.
so when they won, it was, yeah, look, it sucks to lose, but
absolutely. Whatever,
at least it went to one of our heroes, too.
Right, right, absolutely. Know? Now, speaking of Megadeth, obviously we all know and concerned about Dave's health. Mm-hmm. I guess the only tour you guys are going to do, or not even a tour, is going to be the Mega Cruise, right?
Right.
And is there any plans after that, or...
Well, we don't know, you know, really to what degree we're going to participate on that, and or in what fashion we're going to participate in it.
Right.
I mean, because a lot of it just comes down to Dave's, you know, how he's feeling at that time after right. he's gone through his treatments and everything. I mean, he right. definitely needs the time to heal. I mean, he's a singer, so he's got to take his time to heal. But yeah, I mean, look, we have plans well into 2020.
Okay, great.
Like Dave's statement said, we just pretty much had to clear the deck through 2019.
Right.
Just to go through the treatments. But yeah, we have a whole bunch of stuff planned for next year. Hopefully we won't have to move any of that, and that'll stay put in best case scenario. Worst okay. case scenario is, hey, he needs a little time to recover. We just kind of move some things to the side for a bit. And but yeah, I mean, look, we're hopeful we can get back on the horse and get going next year.
Absolutely. Yeah. How was it playing with Kiko Loureiro after the last two albums? I'm a huge fan of obviously his early bands, you know, and when his original singer from Viper, the band he was in back in the day, well, actually he was, you know, in Angra with Andre Matas, and he died last month. Right. How is it working with Kiko?
Kiko's great. He's a super phenomenal musician. One of the best musicians I've played with, and I've gotten
really?
To play. I mean, I think about it in Megadeth, man. It's like I have really gotten to play with the top of the top.
Yeah, you have.
Al Petrelli, Chris Poland, obviously Dave, of course. The drummers that we've had, we, you know, just looking back over the legacy, and not only that, but the producers, Dan Huff, Mike Klink, Max Norman.
Rest in peace, two of your drummers.
Yep. Andy Sneap, who I didn't actually get to work, unfortunately, with a full production with him, but
right.
which we were both looking forward to because we're both fans of each other's work, but he did mix the Sudden Death track that I recorded right as I came back into
right,
Megadeth
right,
in 2010.
Right, right.
But, you know, I've really been, held to a really high standard, and it's made me such a better player, a better performer. We've had some of the best management in the business, the best agents, you know, and a lot of the guys that we started with were you know, also new in their careers, so we kind of grew up together back in the 80s and the early 90s, so that was kind of fun to be. You know, there's a lot of unknown, you know, because you're kind of growing up together in the business.
Absolutely.
Our manager, Ron Lafitte, who manages us, rest in peace, through euthanasia. Andy Summers, who was an agent of ours back. He basically came in to help salvage the Killing Is My Business tour. And, you know, and he's then went on to, you know, I mean, he's an agent for Brian Wilson and Social Distortion.
Awesome.
And a lot of, you know,
okay.
he still books Marty Friedman. And
that's awesome.
You know, so it's just kind of cool that we've grown up and been friends, remained friends with so many people over
right.
the years, you know.
And I guess all these contacts and all these relationships you've had for the last 35 years have allowed you to branch out, and now you're doing the solo,
right.
the solo tour, second book.
Yeah.
You worked with, you know, you did Attitudes and Altitudes with Frank Bella from Anthrax.
Yeah.
You've obviously done Metal Allegiance.
Right.
You were talking about your coffee. It's just amazing to see you just do so much.
Yeah, it's, you know, it is. It's you know, when Megadeth disbanded in 2002, and I tell the story in the book. I think I told a little bit of it in My Life with Deth. I elaborate a little bit more on
okay.
it in More Life with Deth. It's kind of the center of the story, actually, which is, you know, just say yes to things, you know. And I was scared because, you know, a lot. I was in a, you know, I grew up in a band that became very popular. My whole image, my lifestyle, my income, everything was tethered to that. And one day
right.
that just ended. Dave called
right.
up and said, look, I gotta quit Megadeth.
And that's when he had the arm thing, right?
February 2002. Yep,
right,
exactly.
Right.
And
after
all of a sudden
failed,
my
right.
whole world came to an end, and at least as I knew it, but yet a whole new life developed out of that. And and you know, I was fortunately raised well on a farm in the Midwest,
right.
you know, so you know it, work ethic, and I had a family to support, and my kids were real young, and, you know, so, you know, my ass was to the fire, you know, I mean, I had to get going. I couldn't sit around and wait and go, well, maybe one day the band will come back. It's like, you know what, fuck that, I'm going, man, I got to get rolling. And and that really, you know, it helped. I enjoyed, as much as I like being part of a group, there's a part of me that kind of from a leadership point of view that I really enjoy also being on my own. To do these things, and it's nice to have both. I wouldn't want either one or the other. I enjoy having both.
And your collaboration with Thom Hazaert, did you start the EMP label and Combat, or was that the two of you guys
together?
It was
the two of us together. Yeah, it started when I saw this little group Dollskin, this little teenage female group out of I saw him play their very first show at my son's high school. and they formed at the School of Rock. But it was one of those moments I saw him and went, holy cow. I mean, look, I've been seeing a ton of bands, obviously, for a lot of years.
Yeah, absolutely.
And even on The World Needs a Hero, when we signed our deal with Sanctuary Records.
An underrated album, by the way.
Yeah, thank you. And that label was Rod Smallwood's label that he put together.
Right, Sanctuary, absolutely. Of course.
And through that, we had an imprint opportunity to foster and bring in other bands. And I was really actively looking for stuff. And then all of a sudden, Megadeth came to an end, and the whole thing just kind of shut down. But it was funny, through that process is when I started to really get the hankering for producing and doing other things outside of, you know, just being the bass player of Megadeth. And I think that whole season from 2002 until I came back to Megadeth, I branched out and I did a lot of stuff. I did a lot of producing. Problem with producing for me is I get cabin fever. I like to be on the stage. To me, I like to write, I like to record, but to me, recording is a means to an end. It's a process by which you capture your thoughts, which are your songs, and you essentially take a snapshot of them so that you can put out an album so you can get on tour. Because to me, performing is where it's at. You can't duplicate that thing that we, whether it's a little club like tonight or a, you know, the big stadiums we played at the Big Four. There's a thing that happens when you're just in the room with people making music together, you know, and we're all loving it and we're digging it and we're feeling the vibe in the room. The internet can't capture it. You can't capture it on a recording. There's just something there that, and so to me, you know, as much as I like to produce and develop and even, you know, manage some groups, you know, for me, it's I do better with the bass in my hand, being the guy out doing it myself. And that's probably why I'm here tonight, doing this on my own rather than just sitting at home collecting a check while someone else is doing
it. Right, and I'm in awe about it. Actually, last time I interviewed, I think it was about 7 years ago, mm-hmm. when you were with F5.
Right.
And it's interesting because then Steve joined Flotsam.
Yes.
And I know he plays on your new album. And speaking on your new album, speaking of the whole Sleeping Giants, you've got F5 demos on there.
Yeah.
You've got the song with John Bush, which is, if I'm correct, was that a Seven Witches demo or something?
That was a track I wrote with a friend of Nick Menz's.
Rest in peace.
A friend of his, named Pat Chunk. We went through a season in 1993, Countdown to Extinction tour. We had a break, and he and I wrote like 14 songs. And that's why I put a bunch of them on the Sleeping Giants record. In fact, even on the digital, on iTunes, there's even a few more of those cuts.
Yeah, I heard about that. Right.
David Glen Eisley singing on those. Yeah, and that one we had John Bush come over and sing on it. And I sing it live, actually. And I've been loving it because, you know, even with me and Frank, with Altitudes and Attitude, Frank would always say, man, you need to sing more. You should sing more. But in Altitudes and Attitude, Frank has got the nice centerpiece vocal for that band. Here doing this, and especially with things like If You Were God, and there's even another F5 track that I sing on called Feel Your Pain, those are songs that really suit my voice well. You know, they're nice and clear. I'm a real clean singer. I'm a clean player. I'm very, you know, it's just my nature. I don't like a lot of chaos and distortion and all that, which is why I bring Tom in, because Tom's good with sort of bringing heavier, rough thing, which is good. So it's nice that we have the both of those, you know. And I think Hammer Comes Down is a perfect example on the record, because Tom, I put him to the task of writing a lyric and putting a vocal down, because I couldn't come up with anything. For years I've had that music and I just haven't been able to get anything on it. So he did, and he wasn't totally... He goes, this is as good as it's going to get. And I heard it, and I went, you know what? It needs a clean vocal. And right away it hit me, you know what? Call Eric AK from Flotsam. Let me get AK on there. And Eric and Tom together are a perfect match. And that kind of is what Tom and I do out here. I'm the clean guy, and he's got the gruffness. Yeah. And between the two of us, it's kind of like Paul Stanley and Gene Simmons.
Right, right.
Gene's real gruff, and Paul's clean. You know, and I like that. It's good to have that, I think, in a vocal dynamic in a group.
And you mentioned Eisen, which is interesting because he sang for House of Lords and GIUFFRIA.
Yeah.
And I've noticed now with Combat, you know, for me, Combat in the 80s was Abattoir and it was just, you know, it was Hellstar. It was all the great bands. Yeah. And now it's interesting to see, like, the Ron Keel Band.
Right.
And, you know, and Last Crack and stuff. So it's interesting to see, the hair rock mixed in with the thrash, like maybe Hatchet and Green Death and stuff. And I think that's interesting what Combat represents. I know I'm a huge fan of Virus Force Recon, and it seemed like that was going to get a reissue. And I talked to him about it, and he said it should, and it never kind of sort of did. And I was really hoping that would actually finally be on CD, not be a thousand bootlegs that are out there. But it is kind of see that Combat is like representing what it was 35 years ago, but also like new and a good blend. Was that your decision?
Well, the thing I said to Thom is, if we're going to revive this thing, I want it to be a full-blown thrash and punk label. You know, CBD, weed, frickin' beer, wine, skateboards. I mean, whatever the thrash culture is today, I want it to be that. I want it to be that because that's what it deserves to be. So, you know, so I put him to task on that, and he gets it. I mean, I don't need to tell him that. He already knows that. So it's great with that because Thom's got great instincts with the label stuff. You know, I'll bring him some things, and he'll go, man, I tell you what, look, if you want me to sign it, I will, because it's your label, and it's your name on it, but I tell you what, I got 10 more that are twice as good as that, you know, and I've learned a lot from Thom with that, you know, that, and a lot of it is just, you know, like Archer Nation is out here with us, we got the Dead by Wednesday guys playing in my band here tonight.
You played a couple shows with Wrath,
and Clayton from Hatchet, who's also on Combat, they're playing. So again, this is a very in-house thing. When we do these tours, these Basstory tours, we bring all of our family together, because there's strength in numbers, and quite honestly, all boats rise. As the water rises, all boats rise, and to me, you know, it's a lot of hard work for these bands to be out doing this, and suddenly if they come in under my name, you know, bang, it all gets bigger, the presence gets bigger. Yeah, so, you know, to me, if, you know, we always said in Megadeth, like when we were doing album credits, we said, well, ink is free, and to thank somebody on an album, it doesn't cost us any more to write their name in there, and that name is forever imprinted on an album, and it really means a lot for someone to see their name in there. And I think we do the same thing here when we can bring our own boys out on these tours like this under my name. You know, the ink is free. You know, the Wrath logo on a poster doesn't cost us anything, and it's a good look, and it's a great way to
be able to have Gary Goldsweiser's and the guys back.
Yeah.
You know, and
and it's a great way to throw something back to our home team.
Yeah, and I know back in the 80s, before there was internet or anything like that, I thrived on reading thank list and everything else and liner notes and everything else. So when these labels do reissue stuff like the you know, like, say, a Dive Bomb or something like that, you know you're going to get all that stuff. Like,
I still do it. You know, it's funny. Thom knows that I don't like the sound of vinyl. I really don't. And I know that pisses people off.
Oh, my God.
I really don't. I didn't like it back in the day. I had to learn to play bass to it. I mean, I remember sitting in my basement with my Zenith stereo when I was a kid growing up, learning to play, you know, all of fucking Iron Maiden Killers album. And I had to pick the needle up and move it back and drop it. Then it would skip. And then it would skip. And then it would get the lint on it. And so I love digital. I love the sound of it. I love, especially Pro Tools HD rigs. I mean, they sound as good as any of the analog stuff. And that's me. Now, again, there's a lot. Analog, recording is a huge process between mic pre's and tube mics and all that stuff. So you can't just go... You can't single it out to one thing. A recording process is an involved, you know, signal chain to get an audio recorded. But just as a listener, I buy everything digital. Okay. And then, but what I do is I go back and I buy in the cheap bin. I buy like the $6.99 and $7.99, the old Guess Who records.
Oh, yeah, me too.
38 Special, Montrose.
What did I just...
38 Special, right? Yeah.
Jethro Tull.
So what I do is, like you said, I buy those and I listen to it on iTunes, and then I also, then I open up the album and I read the credits as if I'm listening to it, right? And I have my stereo at home, and I, once in a while, I'll put my vinyl on at home and I'll listen to it. But it's, again, it sounds shitty. I'm like, yeah, this is why I stop listening to this stuff, because it's all blinty and
I just got Jethro Tull Aqualung, you know? And even the 40th anniversary still doesn't come with lyrics. Got all these great liner notes, all these interviews, all stuff.
Yeah.
And so I had to go to the library and get the songbook, you know, the music, and then actually had the lyrics in it. So I'm actually learning the lyrics to Cross-Eyed Mary and you know, and finally understanding like all the references and, you know, Locomotive Breath. Like, wait a minute, this is really, especially England-based, some of the like Hampstead, right. You know. So, you know, I digress.
Well, and what's funny is I went to Best Buy one day, and there was a guy, he was a fan, and so he brought me back into the stereo room, where they've got the $50,000 Macintosh power amps and all this crap. And he puts on an Adele record, and I sit there, and he plays it for me. Which, you know, again, and he goes, dude, give me a copy of Dystopia. We don't have one here. And I said, I should bring you a copy of Dystopia, so you at least get some fucking slamming music to play.
I bought Dystopia from Best Buy.
And I get it, the 180 grain vinyl and everything. I get the whole thing, but you gotta understand, I stand in front of millions of dollars of the best audio equipment in the world every day when I'm on stage playing. So to me, to sit in front of, I would never pay $50,000 to buy a fucking stereo to hear music that I already stand in front of speakers and play. Right? I mean, it's just me, and that's me as a creator and a recording and everything of doing it. And I'm fortunate enough to be in, you know, some of the best studios in the world where I can hear the stuff as we're making it. And again, to me, music, on that level, you're kind of almost in like a laboratory, you know?
Right.
We were just up at Sweetwater Sound today listening to some tracks that they had recorded. And it just amazes me how good the recording process has gotten. With the quality of the microphones and the studios and just everything that there is. At the same time, I love to go back and watch Grohl's movie Sound City, you know, because a lot of the records I grew up on, Cheap Trick, Bachman Trigger, all these things that were, they were all recorded. A lot of them, you know, a lot of them were cut into Sound City. And Megadeth, we never worked at Sound City. There's one studio we never went to for whatever reason, you know, producers that we used, we never cut records there. But, you know, so look, I'm fascinated by all of it. I, you know, as a fan of music, as a fan of audio and recording and performing, it's, you know.
I will say I did purchase that Dystopia at Best Buy with whatever those earphones in the box. I still love the cover of the box. But we talked that you're wearing an Alethea shirt, who played with the other night from Cleveland. What other new bands have you discovered that you know with this recent tour that are like, you know, really surprising you?
Well, look, I you know, it's funny, like that was one. I mean, it was great, and all of a sudden, again, we have a lot of groups on these bills, and I try to, you know, I don't get here sometimes early enough to hear all of them,
of course, right?
But that's one that just caught my ear. I'm like, god, it was, and all of a sudden I'm like, well, that's a chick singing.
Yeah,
she's
Chris has,
freaking,
yeah,
great.
Did she do the fire thing on stage?
I didn't see that. Okay. I heard the dressing room was close by to the stage, so I pretty much heard their whole show, and she was great. I mean, we were all commenting like, wow, this band is really good. And then I saw the t-shirt and I'm like, that's a great logo. So someone from our staff went and got me a t-shirt. So that's the kind of shirt David would wear.
We've known Chris and her husband for what, 16 years now?
Chris and Ron.
And the crazy, the Cleveland metal scene. Yeah. Now, I'm a little confused on the coffee thing. We saw the merch table and I saw you had Twisted Sister and Skid Row. I mean, are these guys actually making their own blend of coffee?
Yeah, we make roast for these guys, yeah.
Yep. She's the coffee genius. I don't know nothing about coffee.
Eddie Ojeda, we make some for him, for the Skid. I mean, some people just have great nails because the Skid Row slave to the grind. I mean, come on, that's, you must be a coffee house right there.
Exactly.
But Autograph, we made some for me and Frank Bello.
Really?
Yeah. We do it. Yeah, and it's fun because, look, it's just an extra fun merch item for people. It's just kind of part of their branding. Just like, you know, we did for me and, you know, for some of the things that I do. So, you know, and it's fun to just kind of, again, it's a good way to tie our community together. And some people have beer, some people have wine. Everybody should have coffee because if you drink too much beer and wine, you're going to need some coffee.
That's great. And you don't see too much coffee. Now, I have to say, and I have to say on the record, what do you think of the Megadeth beer? Because I bought it and I love the Toot Limone logo on it.
Yeah.
But it tastes awful.
I don't drink.
Okay. Well, I don't either. I only buy the beer. I buy the Trooper beer, and I bought Enter Night Metallica beer, and I bought the, you know, because of the logos and the labels, and then I collected.
Look, I have a bottle of the Atulamon beer at my house just because
Megadeth beer. Right.
I have the Kiss Cola there too.
Right. Yeah.
Cola, you know. So, but yeah, I don't drink alcohol, so I have not tasted it.
Oh, okay. So you haven't even tasted it.
Haven't even tasted it. Yep.
Oh man.
So the beer. And again, look, we have with Combat, we have some cider and wine and beer and stuff. But okay. I don't drink, so I don't say that stuff, you know. So.
Yeah, I'm not a connoisseur of alcohol either. I'm just not a big thing. But as soon as I saw the Motorhead beer and all these, I had to get in. Trooper Ale is actually really good. And now there's five Trooper Ales, including one that's got sake in it. So, you know, more power to them. And you're right. I think it's great. You see the wine, you see the beer, you see all these merchants. And I think this is the first time I've seen coffee. And I didn't know you had the coffee thing. So that's
I thought the coffee thing was unique.
It is unique.
It is. I thought it was something that's, and it's me, because I drink coffee. It's part of my lifestyle. It's part of what I do. And, I think people found it kind of fascinating. Like, wow, everybody's kind of got these beers now, but, you know, Ellefson's got coffee. So I'm known as the coffee guy now.
That's awesome. So, in closing, we always have you pick a song off your current album or anything like that.
Yep.
What would you choose?
You know what? Let's go with If You Were God.
If You Were God. That's the one you sing on, right?
Yeah, it's one I sing on. Yeah, again, on the recording, it's my friend John Bush on there, and it's just live. It's really, it's turning into a favorite.
That's awesome. Yep. That's awesome. Well, Dave, it was a true honor. I can't believe I'm sitting in the car with you. That's just amazing, and looking forward to seeing you live.
Awesome. Thank you.
See you. Bet.
Someone lose. If you were God, you'd have to choose. If you were God, what?